This is Pony Prepper Bill. Today I want to bring you a video. I was talking to a couple people about the possible power outages and the cyber attacks and what I think is going to happen. And a couple people, you know, I was talking about, like, you know, it's just like preparing for Y2K when that happened, you know, in the year 2000, when everything was supposed to roll over and the computers were going to break down and shut down. And it ended up being a non-event, but it was something a lot of people were preparing for. Some people did, some people didn't. But a couple people, I forget, are younger and don't know what I'm talking about the Y2K and preparing. And I was going through some of my videos and I came across two videos. And one of them is this one, hosted by Leonard Nimoy. I'll put a thing up there. And it came out in 1998. About the possible Y2K crash in the computers and what could happen. Well, I put this on the computer, edit it. It's like an hour long. I edit it down to 20 minutes. Even though it's not the Y2K computer crash, the scenario was almost the same, or the outcome. This was the computer crashing and everything shutting down. Hospitals and your electric and sewage and all that. This is still more likely. I mean, I would prepare for this. Forget the computer stuff. When I say Y2K, just figure EMP or cyber attack. Today, a cyber attack is more likely than anything. There's been cyber attacks going on, like every week there's something going on. So I just cut some stuff out of here. Cut it down to 20 minutes. And this is like a family survival guide. Forget Y2K. Just figure family survival guide for the power going out, for a cyber attack on our power grid. This is Pony Prepper Bill. And if people like this, you know, if you like it, if I get a lot of views or something, if you want, I found another one for Y2K that's similar, but it's a different video. And I'll cut that down and make that and put that up here for you. So this has got some good ideas for family planning for a cyber attack on our power. This is Pony Prepper Bill, and I'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
There is an ancient myth of what may have been the most highly advanced civilization ever to dwell on the planet Earth. Legend has it that this civilization was perhaps more technologically advanced than our human civilization is today, on the brink of the third millennium AD. But the legend also ends suddenly with the revelation that this entire ancient civilization vanished, that their great island sank into the sea because their technological innovations were too far ahead of their human judgments, human foresight, and simple human frailties. This legendary civilization was, of course, Atlantis. Yet the problem for us in the year 1999 is that we are no longer musing on what may or may not have happened a long, long time ago. Rather, we are now facing very real global issues related to power supply, satellite communications, water, healthcare, transportation, distribution of food, and other items vital to everyday human survival. And so, we recall the fate of Atlantis. Have we allowed our own highly advanced technological innovations to far outpace our human abilities to control those innovations? And most importantly, to foresee their ultimate consequences?
We're not going to be able to predict with any certainty where the breakdowns may or may not occur. Will it be a nuclear power plant? Will it be the airplanes in the sky? Will it be the food supply chains, transportation? There are so many possibilities.
It is our primary goal in this program to help families and communities across the world to prepare and to work together regardless of what may or may not occur. And unless we appreciate what may occur, we may not be ready, either individually or as a civilization. Elevators may stop. Heat may vanish. Credit cards and ATMs may cease to function. Airplanes and trains may come to a halt. Telephones and televisions may not utter a sound. Water delivery systems may not deliver water for cooking, drinking, or bathing. Streetlights, stoplights, lights in buildings everywhere may flicker out. Hospitals, clinics, pharmacies may be unable to provide proper medical care. Banks and stock markets around the world may suffer some form of meltdown. And nuclear power plants may cease to generate the electricity we need for all aspects of our daily lives.
What is going to happen is a combination of events, hundreds of thousands of events, literally across the globe, that will affect other systems.
You will start to see systems coming down.
You have a potential for power outages, water outages.
My main worry is the energy grid.
And if we can't get power, we can't get water.
Communities will have disruptions, and maybe this other community will have a different disruption than this one.
So it's something that is totally unpredictable.
We're talking about a loss of a way of life, you know, our dependence on this uninterrupted life in which the energy grid supplies a lot of our needs on a daily basis.
You're going to see some real dislocation, panic, fear.
And the problem globally is worse than it is here.
It starts with you. And I think if everybody does their job and puts a lot of thought in it and does the right thing and just simply prepare, then I think you'll make it just fine.
The reality is no one knows exactly what's going to happen. So, the real dilemma facing not only world leaders, but each one of us, is how to find a clear, reasonable, balanced approach between those who call for extreme survival measures versus those who advise no action at all. The very best we can hope to do, therefore, is to prepare as individuals and as families so that we each feel secure, and to work together in small and large communities as local and global neighbors.
Hi, I'm Ted Wright. I spent 4.5 years in Special Forces, almost continuous combat. And I traveled from El Alamein in Rome. I was part of the Desert Rats team. And I ended up at outside Rome. And I survived Anzio. I have seen just about every condition of human misery and privation in my time. I am a family safety preparedness consultant. I've been doing what I do for 18 years. I'm happy to be a part of this team, and I hope that our message will be received positively.
Concentrate on basic needs that you might have to spend a couple of weeks using those supplies before a distribution system is renewed.
I think it's a very important thing for communities to have a constructive dialogue with their elected leaders and their local businesses about what their state of preparedness is and what their state of readiness is.
Learn how to put a little water away. Know how much per person to put away. Know how much cash you're going to need on hand, if any. Know what you're going to do.
Water, and I've said it for years, is going to be a prime problem in this country with regards to fresh drinking water. It's already a problem now. It's been highlighted in newspapers, periodicals, magazines have all run specials on this. Have a minimum of at least 4 weeks' water for each family member in storage as soon as possible. 1 gallon per person is accepted by FEMA and the Red Cross as the very basic requirement. So for 1 month, 30 gallons per person is your target. Other than buying water, fill every container that you use. Milk, juice, soda pop, rinse it out and fill it with fresh tap water and store containers in a cool, dark place. I have containers all over my house, all over my yard. I have them in the bedroom, I have them in the linen closet. Store them, store them, store them. Fresh water, properly stored, lasts for years. The enemy of water is light and heat. We now have excellent technical advances that have resulted in very compact, portable, inexpensive water filters that we can process our water through and know that it's safe to drink no matter how long it's been in storage. If you're in doubt, filter the water using a good water filter, now available in the $30 range and up. Be sure it is at least a 0.05 micron or less, because then it will filter out possible bacteria. But if you have no filter and have doubts, boil the stuff. And now let's talk about storing water for purposes other than drinking. Picture this. You get up one day, you go to the bathroom and discover you don't have water. You then realize you only have one flush per toilet. And then things are going to get nasty and unpleasant. What do you do about this? Well, ahead of time, store water in volume for this purpose. Next to the need for drinking water, need for flushing water is number two. Fill trash cans, drums, or any large containers, no matter if they're clean or not. We're not talking about drinking water here. We're talking about toilet water. Quantity, not quality, is the order of the day. In rainy areas, put barrels under the gutter spout and you have free water. Now, in most of the manuals put out by the Red Cross and FEMA, it tells you to put a plastic trash bag in your toilet and use the toilet normally, seal the bag when it's sufficiently finished. But that is one of the most destructive things we can possibly do, and I urge everybody, as I have done for years, do not use plastic bags for your toilet. As soon as you seal the bag, the waste inside starts to cook, and that generates germs, it generates all sorts of bacteria. So those plastic trash bags are going to deteriorate and you're going to have a potential for an outbreak of disease like you never saw before. If the toilet doesn't work, a chemical toilet is the answer. The chemical toilet is most desirable for family safety. They're very affordable, costing even less than $60. If you cannot afford a chemical toilet, well, a good-sized bucket and an adapted toilet seat will work if you're careful. Use this toilet and when finished, empty down the regular toilet. By observing the reaction of the flushing as you dump the homemade chemical toilet, you will learn how much water to keep in the bucket at all times. Under no circumstances dump the chemical toilet waste of any kind in the yard. Let's take the example of an apartment complex with 50 units in it. We have to get together. We have to put the responsibility on the owner or the management of the apartment buildings to make a communal toilet, to pull in the toilets that we see on the construction sites, etc. If people have to pay an extra dollar a month in their rent to make sure they have some toilets out there for them, like we do at expositions and ball games. If they can do it for ball games and gatherings, we can do it for an apartment complex or condominium complex. Personal hygiene is always a problem with no water. Stock up on baby wipes. Clean underarms and private areas daily with baby wipes.
The next thing you want to do is really get stuff that you eat, that you're used to eating, that will last into the year 2000. There's tons of things such as tuna fish, potted meat, all kinds of potted meat products, bean products.
And so we're urging that people prepare food, water, other things for about a month to 6 weeks. The other aspect of that is that we're urging people strongly not to think that they can survive this alone. This is about community. It's about networks. And so beyond about a month, you have to be networked and you have to be in community. There's no way any one family could lay aside, you know, enough food, enough resources to survive this thing on their own.
You need to have a minimum of 4 weeks of food for this emergency for each family member. Same as the water, remember? And also, pets are family members, and they need food and water for the same period of time. The body needs a high concentration of protein and minerals to stay healthy. 50 to 60 grams of protein a day is a good guide, and the average adult should consume this much protein. That is approximately 1,500 grams of protein a month. If you have the time, a dehydrator is worth its weight in gold at this particular time. Homemade jerky can be stored with white rice to absorb any extra moisture it may have after processing. Mary Bell's book on dehydrating food is a great resource if you want to try home dehydrating.
We must learn the fundamentals and be like a squirrel. We must get a little bit and put it away, a little bit and put it away. In my own teachings, I teach the bin method. I talk about a 30-gallon trash bin, but it can be a smaller container. You need a container with a good tight lid that you can put food in.
Once you have stored your protein, then work on storing other foods you will need. Here are some suggestions. Dried beans, rice, powdered milk, dried fruit, powdered protein drinks, alfalfa seeds for sprouting, and any canned foods you might like. If you have the money, MREs, meals ready to eat, can be purchased from military surplus stores or from many sites on the internet. The sooner you start your preparations, the better your opportunity to get the supplies you need at reasonable prices.
Y2K specifically is going to affect our utilities and our services. We can't do anything about the telephone, we can't put the power back on, but we have to have alternate means of heating and alternate means of lighting.
Now that we have covered the subjects of food and water storage, let's move on to the problems of staying warm and having emergency lighting. If you have a fireplace or a wood stove and you don't have any fuel or you've run out of fuel, you can burn newspapers hand-rolled into logs. Basically, you roll the newspapers very tightly and fasten them with metal wire. As for heat, a good modern kerosene heater is the way to go. They are safe, do need ventilation, of course, but are very efficient and economical, using under 10 gallons a week, burning 10 hours a day. I stress the need to reduce the logistics. Don't try to heat the whole house. Select one room large enough for the family and use that one room for living in. For this four-week period, it's not that big a deal. There is a new long-life flashlight, and boy, it's apart from all the rest. I have one, and it's just amazing. Mine will go 2 years on one battery. Candles are a pleasant but controversial light source. If you are going to use them, be very, very careful, as they can be as dangerous as they are useful, especially around children. You may want to purchase an oil lamp from your favorite discount store. Oil lamps are one of the most economical ways to provide emergency lighting. 2 gallons of lamp oil is approximately a month's supply using your oil lamp 5 hours a day. There is also the crank radio and light that is very, very efficient. Hot meal? Sure, if you want to. Keep warm? Why not, in a reduced living area? Be sure to stockpile plenty of the fuels you know you'll be using, such as firewood, kerosene, lamp oil, etc. You may want to have fire starter bricks and extra lighters available. Make sure you have plenty of batteries on hand for your flashlights. If you don't already have one, a fire extinguisher. You should have a good basic first aid kit.
I have urged people for years, go to your doctor and ask for an extra prescription so you can cycle your prescriptions, have a month ahead of you. No doctor will issue a prescription ahead of time. We have to change the thinking of the AMA. And the medication problem, as far as I'm concerned, is a time bomb waiting to go off, and it's going to be very, very serious.
Make sure you have enough prescription medicine to last for this period of time. You will need to talk to your doctor about this. Home remedies and herbal teas. Have a good 4-week supply of toilet paper, paper towels, lawn trash bags, diapers if you have a baby, feminine products, contact lens solution, and good personal grooming items of your choice. You will need handy tools such as duct tape, a handsaw, crowbar, hammer and nails, pliers, screwdrivers, and rope.
You may want to put some money aside because that you may not be able to get to your bank. Your bank may be down for a week or two, and it would be a discomfort. People may not accept checks, so having some cash might be a good idea.
People don't usually understand the idea of fractional reserve banking, that when they make a deposit, only a very small portion is actually kept with the bank. Even of that deposit, only 1.2% of our total money supply is in cash. So that if everybody ran to the banks tomorrow, they'd only be getting maybe a penny on the dollar in return if they wanted in cash. Well, that kind of information floating around in society is what's going to cause some tremendous panic, I think.
It may be a good idea to have some cash on hand, although experts vary in their opinions. By personal choice, put coin and cash away as much as you feel you are comfortable with. Get a copy of all financial records such as bank statements, mortgage statements, credit card statements, and all important documents. Store them in a safe place. Have written proof of financial assets as much as you can. We do not recommend pulling all of your money out of the bank. Just document what is there. Tell your children they don't have to worry about Y2K because your family will be prepared if the water or electricity goes out for a few days.
With children, it's very important to reassure kids that this is not the end of the world. Involve them in a meaningful way. You know, if it comes to storing a little food or, you know, putting batteries in the flashlights, you give kids a meaningful role in the process, because it literally is true that in times of catastrophe, everyone is a leader at one time or another.
If your child is old enough to understand Y2K and to help out around the house, you need to explain Y2K to him. Let him help prepare. If the child is not old enough to help you or understand Y2K, then don't tell them. I mean, it'll be part of their life experience that they'll, children are pretty resilient. They'll figure this is normal.
Be sure you have provided for your well-being and morale. Have games that require no electricity, books, playing cards, puzzles, and crafts. These will keep you and your children happily occupied. Tell your friends and relatives that preparing for temporary shortages and outages caused by Y2K is a good insurance policy. You don't expect your house to burn down, but you're still insured against that possibility. Now that you have seen some of the ideas in this program, you know how easy it is to start your own short-term preparations. Many people, especially those who live alone, are overwhelmed by the potential of this Y2K dilemma. Remember, all problems have a solution, and people will continue to work on the problems we have outlined in this presentation.
I'm going to buy a generator and at least enough of water for a month's supply, of food.
Basically, we're prepared for a couple of 3 months. I don't think it'll last that long, but it's not that expensive in 1999 prices early.
I plan to do and is to store a month's worth of food and a month's worth of water.
I will make my bank send me all my records. I'm keeping all my receipts for all of my medical expenses for the year 2000 or for the year 1999.
Why don't you test yourself? Why don't every home test? Why not go home next weekend? Why not Friday night? Turn the box off, turn the electric off, go shut the water off, okay? Have a few bucks in your pocket, see what you need.
Y2K is a computer problem, but it's going to face the individual with their own reality. Whatever that reality is, it's going to face you face to face with a mirror. And in that mirror, there's going to be you.
Here's a checklist to help you, your family, and your community prepare for Y2K. Do you have at least a 3-week supply of water on hand? Do you have at least a 3-week supply of food ready? Primarily canned and dried foods, which are not dependent upon refrigeration for freshness. Do you have hard copies of all your important documents, such as bank statements, stocks, assets, birth certificates, and so on? Do you have emergency independent lighting, such as flashlights, kerosene lamps, oil lamps, candles, and matches? Since Y2K will happen in the dead of winter, if you live in colder climates, do you have emergency heating methods or other means to stay warm, such as a well-prepared fireplace, at least 3 weeks of kindling, real or synthetic fireplace logs, as well as sleeping bags, heavy quilts, heavy coats, thick gloves, thermal underwear, and socks? Do you have backup cooking methods available, such as a kerosene camping stove, barbecue with ample supply of charcoal, or a fireplace and cookware appropriate for an open flame? If you are continuously reliant upon prescription medicine, have you made provisions with your doctor to have at least a 3-month supply of medicine after January 1st, 2000? Likewise, if you have a medical condition which requires continuous care, have you made provisions with your doctor to make sure your necessary medical care will be uninterrupted throughout the year 2000? Do you have a first aid kit, and have you customized it for the potential needs of you and your family? If you have critical care home nursing equipment, have you checked with the seller or manufacturer to make sure that none of the equipment may be affected by Y2K microchip failure? If you'll be pregnant in the year 2000, have you made special provisions with your doctor to ensure a smooth delivery of your newborn child? In the event that telephone systems, satellite networks, television, or radio temporarily become inoperative, do you or your nearby neighbors have a ham radio as a backup for communications and to keep abreast of newsworthy developments? Have you made specific plans to secure heirlooms and other valuables important to you and your family? Have you contacted your local phone, water, and power companies, both about uninterrupted service and about accurate billing statements in the year 2000? If you live in a skyscraper or other high-rise dwelling, have you and your co-tenants conferred with building management regarding backup generator for the entire building, regarding emergency provisions for heat, light, water, and waste management? If you live in a community of neighborhood homes, have you begun organizing with family, friends, and town leaders to prepare contingency plans for the first 2 to 3 months of the year 2000, particularly regarding emergency food, water, and heat provisions? Have you made special contacts with any elderly or disabled folks to see if they could use a little help? And have you communicated with your local, county, state, and federal representatives to make sure they're doing everything in their power to prepare for Y2K? Finally, one good thing to remember regarding all of these items of preparation is that regardless of what may or may not occur as a result of Y2K, all of these things will still be useful to you and your family. And the efforts to organize with our neighbors will be beneficial to all parties concerned, no matter what does or does not happen. There is an ancient myth of what might have been the most highly advanced civilization ever to dwell on the planet Earth. But that is indeed just an ancient myth. We are now, without question, living in one of the greatest periods in all human history. It's both an exciting and challenging time to be alive. We both enjoy and are awestruck by the unbelievably rapid advancements in human ingenuity and technology. Yet, how fragile do we now find ourselves before the juggernaut of our own inventions? In a very real way, we're all responsible for Y2K, and there's no one to blame, morally or otherwise. We've all benefited from the technologies which have improved our lives, and we have therefore encouraged those same technologies to develop at ever more accelerated rates. And yes, perhaps we are now realizing that we've taken them a bit for granted and have indeed become too dependent upon the byproducts of our collective innovations. And so, we must not only prepare as families and work together as neighbors, but we need also use this moment in the development of our civilization as an opportunity to look at the long-range effects of all our human endeavors. Looking beyond Y2K, whatever perils our very human ambitions and short-sightedness may lead us to, our even more powerful human spirit will find a way to overcome. So, let us use the Y2K challenge as an opportunity to reflect on where we're headed as a civilization. Perhaps the most important opportunity we've ever had. If the omission of two simple digits can have worldwide impact several decades after its inception, we must ask ourselves, before we rush too far forward, what are we doing now in genetic engineering, with cloning, with the development of bacteriological warfare life forms, with death ray technologies, and pollution of land, air, and water that could have long-term, unpredictable worldwide effects? And what can we do as the inheritors, the caretakers of this world? What can we do to protect our home, our island in space?